Welcome inside the Schaefer Center here in Waxahachie, Texas, where today the SAGU Lions and Lady Lions play host to Wayland Baptist University. It's doubleheader NAIA basketball action coming up next right here on the SAGU Sports Network.
Here we go, SID, baby. You ready or not? Look on the ones and twos, yeah. SAGU in the place to be. Yeah. Feels good, don't it? Hey, feels good, don't it? Hey, feels good, don't it? Hey, here we go. In the pack, never got slack, pushing for greatness, never looking back. Hear the roar, check the score, can't ignore talent, strength in the Lord. Lions in the pack, never got slack, pushing for greatness, never looking back. Hear the roar, check the score, can't ignore talent, strength in the Lord. Lions in the pack, never got slack, pushing for greatness, never looking back. Hear the roar, check the score, can't ignore talent, strength in the Lord.
Welcome inside the Schaefer Center. He's John Cookman. I'm Rob Price. And we were just like here like a minute ago, Thursday night. Two awesome games, two great wins. We're right back at it, though. Game three or game four is going to have a five-game home stretch. Two big wins against Southwestern Christian. But tonight, WVU is in town. These guys got their hands full. So do the ladies right here up first.
They do. WVU, Wayland Baptist University is for real. It's another for real team. As if you haven't heard us say it before in the Sooner Athletic Conference, top to bottom, all these teams are for real. Some of the best NAIA talent per team in the country. And tonight, it's going to be a very interesting matchup considering that the Lady Lions are coming off of a strong win from Thursday night.
68-65 win over Southwestern Christian. A gut check win.
Very big gut check win. And if you ask these Lady Lions right now, they have no fear. They don't see anything in their way. They're trying to get positioned to get in the Sooner Athletic Conference tournament.
Now, meanwhile, WBU, they're called the Lady, or the Flying Queens, but the guys are called the Pioneers, so we'll have that straight. They come into this game 13-8 overall, 8-3 in conference, receiving votes. Meanwhile, Lady Lions 11-12 and 2-9 in conference play, and I think we got Adam Ferguson right behind me, ready to talk to Coach Arlen Beatles. Adam, what do you got?
Thanks, Rob. I'm here with head coach Arlen Beatles. Now, coach, you had a big win last game against Southwestern Christian and what many might see as an upset. So you are not out of the playoff hunt yet. What do you have to do today to pick up a win against a tough Wayland Baptist team?
Well, you got to really rebound well, and you got to defend the fast break. These guys, now they don't shoot as well as Southwest Christian does, at least they haven't in the past. But, boy, they push it down the floor so quick. They shoot it and rebound it. They're coming off a big win off of beating Texas Wesleyan University. So they're a great team.
Now, Cassie Cox, one of your senior leaders, had 21 points, 13 rebounds, and shot 68% from the field last game. She was a big reason why you guys won. How do you plan to incorporate her into your offense this game?
Well, we hope to do the same thing. Cassie had a little accident yesterday in practice and turned her ankle real bad, so we had to tape her up today. Hopefully, she'll be ready to go. But we had a nice team group there. Taylor had 11 points, and I think Monica Dorsey had 18, so that really helped out.
All right, Coach, good luck. We'll keep an eye on Cassie. Now back to you, Rob.
Thanks, Adam. Thanks, Coach. I'll tell you what a game Thursday night by Cassie Cox. 21 points, 13 points. It's like she was living and breathing at the free throw line, right at that 15-point mark. She was drailing 4, 5, 6 in a row, it felt like.
She had an amazing night, a double-double. 21 points, 13 rebounds. that's what the Lady Lions need.
Again
every night,
tonight, yeah.
But need it from all the players. And if you poll all the players like we have, they're going to tell you they're coming out with 1,000% effort tonight to get this win from WBU.
Taylor Hill still averages double figures. In fact, the only player left in double figures at 10.3. Cassie Cox behind her at 8.8. Speaking of double figures, you got five players on this team that you're about to tell us about who averaged double figures for the Lady the Flying Queens.
That's correct, and I'm sure I'm going to butcher these names, so please forgive me if you're watching in from WBU. My bad. But Stephanie Afonugo, 14 and a half points a game. I remember her from last year. She's the real deal, Rob. Leisha Greer, Laura Castillo, Sean Monreal, and Latorica Anderson with 10. All five of these young ladies are averaging double figures from 15, right under 15 points to 10 points a game. That is a strong lineup, Rob. I mean, bro.
How do you stop
bro.
That? I mean, what do you do?
I mean,
they could implement that 3-2 defense again. It worked well Thursday night. We'll see if Beatles tries a 3-2. This team's receiving votes. They're tied for second in the Sooner. Lady Lions have their hands full. Have a call for you in just a second. Stay tuned right here from the SAGU Sports Network. We'll be right back.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the starting lineup for the Flying Queens from Wayland, University. At guard, sophomore from Kennedy, Texas, number 4, Sean Monreal. At guard, junior from Plainview, Texas, number 11, Laura Castillo. At forward, junior from Plano, Texas, number 15, Stephanie Abrudo. At forward, senior from Mesquite, Texas, number 20, Latorica Anderson. And at forward, senior from Reno, Nevada, number 21, Aisha Greer. Head coach for the Flying Queens is Alicia Robertson Ellis.
Queens ready to take the court. Some last minute high fives as this receiving vote number 2 team in the Sooner Athletic Conference is ready to go on the road here against these Lions right there. Big win Thursday night. This group here, a gutty win, 68-65 against Southwestern Christian. What do you think Coach Beatles told these guys from Thursday night to today?
Just got to keep up the attitude and play hard. Also, tonight's referees are Stephen Miles, Jimmy Calmax, and Daryl Opper.
Hey, one of those guys tipped just the ball right there. We're into play here. It's Dorsey. She corrals the ball, and the possession will go to Lady Lions for the first pass in this game. Here we go. It's going to be Paige into Cox. Good position. And
wow.
That took forever to go in. That was about a three-second roll.
And you got to love it. Cassie Cox picking up from which she left off.
I don't think I've ever seen a ball take that long just to take its sweet time, roll around the rim.
Well, she had to talk to it, and they had a little conversation.
Please be nice to me. Paige again.
Oh,
right
my
side.
Goodness.
Spots
oh,
up.
She oh, saw she... Cassie Cox at the high post.
She did, and she drilled about five shots from that free throw line last game, and so she was looking for her to do the same. Here it is again. She saw her just overshot the mark. Turnover.
Well,
here comes the 3-2 defense. We saw it against Southwestern Christian with Alexis McAfee in the middle. Look, her drop down. She gave all kinds of help.
Oh, my.
And getting past Cox and Page was Aisha Greer. Easy, too, for the Flying Queens.
That was a play by Aisha Greer. Very, very astute in how she stepped to the basket using the baseline as her friend.
And Hill drains a three. Gives the Lions the lead back. This is a good start. Hill's first three goes. A nice little soft touch from Cox early on. And so far, so good. Just one minor turnover there from Page. And another turnover here in favor of the Lions. It's Hill in transition. Stops from 8 feet. No good off the back of the rim. Cleared out by Castillo. She crossed the timeline. And a whistle at the top of the key. A little reach in is going to be either Alexis or Hill. It's going to be Alexis McAfee called for the reach in. You can hear the slap up here. Aisha Greer, who made the bucket. The only player, John, who's 6 foot or above for the Flying Queens. So a height advantage could be checkmark Lady Lions with Page and Cox in there.
Well,
in the paint.
And that's right. And we spoke with the Lady Lions in pregame, and they were adamant about how they were going to come out with a very ferocious game plan here, and very aggressive and work the ball. They feel like they found some chemistry in their half-court offense, and they will create turnovers for a fast-paced type scoring offense as well.
Montreal in the three-pointer there a moment ago. Nice shot inside the Hill. Nice pass.
Oh,
from
great
Cox.
Cut.
Missed it.
Taylor Hill.
On up ahead to Montreal. Just hit a three. Over to Castillo. Three ball, but a whistle. Shauna Montreal fouled as she went up, and she'll shoot three from the charity stripe. Well, I'm not sure what McAfee was thinking. That's two quick fouls on her. She's going to find a spot in the bench, and here comes Croc.
And McAfee, being a young player, but very aggressive and super athletic, finds herself in foul trouble a lot because she is so aggressive. And as she matures as a player, she's going to be able to realize how to tame those early emotions and use her athletic ability to her advantage.
Montreal's second free throw. Look good. It is good. One more coming. Two for two. Castillo, Montreal, check that, averages 10.9 a game. She's one of those five players you mentioned, John, who averages 10.9 from Canyon High School out of Canyon, Texas.
Well,
she goes three for three.
These five young ladies, Flying Queens, we should say, are very talented. Very, very talented. They don't need the height to be able to do what they do best. They're so athletic.
Dorsey tried to get too fancy between the legs. It's a turnover. Montreal shadowed by Page. That's a mismatch. She finds underneath, cutting through. Another nice inside pass from Anderson to Greer, but no good.
Great defense by Charity Page. Keeping her hand right, shadowing the ball, and created a quick steal down low.
Now Page gets it to Kroc from three, short. Page asking for the foul, doesn't get it.
Yeah, understandably. She got grabbed.
Castillo, long three, short.
Oh!
Does that count? I thought that was out of bounds.
No, not at all. It hit the front part. It hit the front part of the glass. It actually has to hit flat on top for it to be out of bounds.
I thought it, maybe my eyes deceived me, John. I thought it hit the top of the backboard.
If it would have hit the top, it wouldn't have dropped down like that.
It's an amazing shot, amazing touch. A little luck involved. Meanwhile, Hill over to Dorsey, works right, from 15, a little off balance, shot no good, loose ball, pulled down by Anderson, and she's fouled.
Yeah,
Monica, take another look at this.
Monica Dorsey is so quick, so fast, but
here it is again.
Very frustrated.
Well, that's the foul. We didn't get a chance to look at the three, but yeah, that's it. Paige, not happy about that call. And Flying Queens up 11-5 after being down 5-2 early, have scored 9 straight points in a hurry. Nice inside passing.
Great, great passing. And one thing that you can see, the maturity level of the Flying Queens is very high. And they've been well coached. You can tell that because they keep moving.
Yeah, Anderson to Greer, too strong. You just pick apart that zone defense.
Yep.
You find the spots and the holes, and that's how you beat the zone defense, is quick, short passing right outside that paint area, because it causes the zone to shift over. If you're in the right spot, it's an easy bucket every single time.
Right, well, you keep moving without the ball, and that's what's happening.
Here's the three, I think. Here,
no, go down to the corner. This is that last play, and a great example of how to keep the low post player moving off the block, off and on, to keep yep. that defense in check. You create your passing lanes, and that's why that pass was so easy to be made.
Easy basketball. It's an easy game when you play fundamental basketball. And right now, the Flying Queens are doing just that, up 13-5. Bit of a scoring drought here. Dorsey, tough shot, but she gets a whistle. She'll go to the line, her first trip to the foul stripe. She just takes the ball and goes in a hurry. And it looks like she was fouled. Yeah, it's going to be on Laura Castillo. That's the first on her, the junior from Plainview, Texas. Dorsey's first free throw is on the mark. Yeah, there's one other six-footer on the bench for Coach Beatles and Tydesha Diggle. She'll get some playing time tonight. So really got three six-footer above, that could give Greer a little trouble. We'll wait to see. But like you said, John, this team doesn't need the height
the way they're playing right now. And I don't know that our little bit of height advantage is going to give Aisha Greer any trouble. She is so talented.
He'll just rip that out of the traffic. And Croc back over to Hill. Boy, Paige is fighting inside against Anderson for position. Now she pops out. Over right side, swing it over to Croc. Looking for Cox. Got a hurt ankle from last game. Stolen easily by Afanago, and she's going to lay it up and in. Hill let her run past. Stephanie Afanago, the junior from Plano, Texas. The team leader in scoring, 14.3, is on the board.
And if I recall correctly, she had a great game the last time she was here in Waxahachie.
Oh, tough shot from Croc, but Cox comes up with it. And fouled going up, that's why I didn't hit anything, not even iron. So she'll go to the line and shoot her first. Yeah, we got word here from our courtside reporter that Cassie Cox has got a bit of a banged up ankle and probably sustained that in the last game, but she's back out there fighting and clawing in the paint. Her first free throw on the way, and it is good.
Well, Cassie Cox is the kind of young lady that will play even better when the pressure's on and the pain is, she's got a real high threshold for pain, but when that pain is on, she just focuses and focuses through all those challenges and obstacles. I expect her to have a really great game tonight. Good defense.
Loose ball, Hill in transition. Numbers aren't there. We'll see what she does. Pops it out to Cox, who got away with the travel. Yep. Nope, now they do call it.
She wasn't planted and just fell backwards, just without dribbling the ball.
6 minutes gone here in game one of two today here at the Schaefer. The Holy Dome, like my color commentator likes to call this home court.
I don't necessarily like to call it that. That's what they call it. That's what the opponents call it.
And that shot off the mark, and another offensive rebound, and missing again was Anderson. Hill crosses midcourt. Lady Lions down 6. into the game is Lakin Ward now. Over to Kroc, right side, keeps her dribble alive. Looking for Cox. Post up low, not there. Over to Dorsey. 10 in the shot clock. And off of Hill's foot, play on. Spins, turns, 14 feet, and she rifles that one in. Like no arc, but just over the front edge of the rim. But true, when it counted, nice shot from Hill. She's got five. Did you see Cox just move Croc's body out of the way? Croc had that rebound. Cox said, no, no, I'm the one that's 6 foot. Give me that rebound.
That's right.
You go play point guard.
Bethany was down there. well, she was down there grabbing the last couple rebounds. And Cassie Cox said, oh, well, that's enough. I this is my job.
Hill, four in the shot clock. I'd make something happen. And we'll play on because the Flying Queens got possession of the ball.
Great
up
pass.
Ahead. Anderson high off the glass.
Big time finish. What a great lead pass. Hit her in stride. Helped her get her footing. And that was a strong finish.
Timeout on the floor. Here it is again in transition right over Ward. And LaTarika Anderson, the 5'10 senior from Mesquite. In fact, West Mesquite High School extends the lead to 6, 17-11.
Well, these Flying Queens are the real deal. And although they're not in first place, OKC or Oklahoma City University seems to be dominating with their undefeated conference year so far. I think that the way the Flying Queens play basketball, they're probably the most formidable opponent that will face Oklahoma City University this year, in the Sooner Conference at least. And if these young ladies keep playing this kind of ball, they're going to wind up going deep in the national tournament.
Winners of 6 of their last 7, John. Their only loss was to number 8 Oklahoma Baptist in his last 7 games, a 64-56 loss on the road. So this team is dialed in right now.
They really are. They're finding themselves, and this is where you want to hit your stretch. And they're hitting that stretch with wins.
And turnover back.
Looked like that bounced off of Bethany's foot as she was dribbling in.
New players in for WU.
Wow.
But it's going to be a starter who nails that one. Shauna Monreal.
Monreal.
Buries a three. The sophomore from Canyon, Texas.
And that wasn't just from the three-point line. She was a good step and a half back. She has some range.
The lead is 9, and another turnover.
Senseless turnovers. You've got to realize, take care of the ball. If you want to be in this game in the end, you've got to be able to take care of the ball every possession. Treat it like you would treat your own money. Take care of it.
Jada Riley in, as well as Honesty Sullivan for Wayland Baptist.
What a great name.
Honesty Sullivan.
Love it.
Alicia Robertson Ellis in her second year at the helm under the Flying Queen. She's 32-12 in her 2 seasons. A solid winning record. McAfee back in. She's got 2 fouls. We need to be careful these last 10 minutes of half number 1. Dorsey now works in the baseline. Shifts left, jumps, and lets it fly. She's fouled. She'll go to the line to shoot. 1-1. I like how she can, she just feels comfortable with both hands. You can see she can dribble right, dribble left, and you got to have that out of your guards, is to be able to not favor one side or the other, because the defense will pick up on that, and they'll deny your strong side. But she's shown she can dribble from either side with confidence.
And she looks like she's coming on strong. She's been working on her free throws, and as a 49% free throw shooter, she's starting to improve and really contribute, and that's how Monica Dorsey will contribute on the offensive side. Is she's a slasher. She's not a great shooter, but she's a slasher, and she can get to the basket.
McAfee still up front. Ward spots up. Jaira Rodriguez in and out. Rebound Anderson on up ahead to Monreal. Back to Anderson on Cox. Frees herself up and misses a really a good look. A short mid-range jumper, but as a big man, you got to put those down. She misses that one.
Well, that's kind of a rare miss. They've been shooting very well.
And before the shot, it'll be against Cox. It's her first foul. She'll go to the bench for 4 points. Now, pretty soon we'll tell all of the SAGU audience members the story behind the Flying Queens. I know all their WBU fans watching know the story, but it's interesting how they got the name Flying Queens. That one flies in. Gabby Gonzalez just checked in, buries a three to extend the lead to 10. Gabby Gonzalez, just a sophomore, 5'5", sophomore from Lubbock, Texas, and a turnover off McAfee, unable to maintain control going baseline.
Well, that's how you get more minutes on the floor, Rob, is you shoot a high percentage from the three-point line.
And another one, back-to-back, Gabby Gonzalez.
100% from the three-point line, ladies and gentlemen.
From the same spot.
Oh, my goodness. Somebody get out on that young lady.
Put a hand in her face. Lead is 13. They've doubled up the Lady Lions, 26-13. You mentioned Dorsey. She's got the ball. She was 4 of 6 from the free throw line in some key moments there Thursday night, John.
And that was huge. They had targeted her as a poor free throw shooting player and put her on the line. And, man, did she contribute. It's a three-point win. She hits 4 of those. You could really give her a lot of the credit.
I remember after the game, it was a no-brainer that Cox was the player of the game. We looked at the stat sheet, and Dorsey had 18.
Yeah, she played a great game.
And Paige goes down, and she stays down. And the refs let the play finish. Then they're going to whistle officials' timeout. And she's grabbing her right knee, it appears, or perhaps her right calf.
No, her ankle.
Oh, it is an ankle. It's a right ankle. I stand corrected. Yeah, there it is. And she rolled that one pretty good. We saw it right there in the replay. And Stuart Dunn, our trainer's out there checking up on Paige. Meanwhile, there's one of the threes from Gonzalez. Just checked into the game. Got a quick 6. Transfer from Howard Junior College. She averages 4.3 a game.
They're going to take her directly to the training room and get that examined. She rolled it real good, and that's if you've ever rolled your ankle, man, oh, man, there's not too many pains that are worse than that immediately.
I'm surprised, John, it doesn't happen more because of all of the feet that are moving in the paint and people jumping up and down. It's a shocking that more feet don't land on feet. That's what happened right there.
It is crazy, and what's even crazier is that it seems to be the new fashionable thing in basketball these days to wear low tops. If you will watch, you'll see more low tops than you see mid or high tops these days.
And what advantage or disadvantage does that give player? As we see up ahead quickly, it's getting right past the Hill, who took a shot at it, is Stephanie Afanugo. So tell me again, you would think the high top, when I was a kid, you wear high tops to protect your ankles.
Well, I remember that I played basketball organizationally since I was 8 years old, and it was a senior in college before I had rolled my ankle, and I wore low tops the whole time, just felt more freeing.
Mm-hmm. Let's go down now to the court side and check in with Adam Ferguson. Adam?
Thanks, Rob. I'm here with former SAGU Lady Lion great Nia Winston. Nia, what's it like to be back and watching your former teammates playing this game?
Well, it's you know, kind of exciting to come out and watch the girls play a little bit and just kind of see how much they've improved and, you know, what they can work on. I sometimes text them and give them advice and things, you know, still trying to be that leader and kind of help them out in situations.
Well, it's nice to see you're still involved. And they are down now. What do you see that they have to do to kind of get back in this game?
Well, most of all, they have to cut back on turnovers. It's crucial to take care of the ball. And then when they're on offense, convert. Just pass the ball. Make sure that you're passing it to an open person. And score. Score the ball.
All right. Thank you, Nia. Back to you, Rob.
Oh,
thank you very much. Adam, we need to – Adam, go check and see if there's an extra jersey in the laundry room. Let's put a jersey on Nia Winston. Get her back on the bench. Get her in the game. Well, we could use her today.
That would be an automatic forfeit, Rob. You cheater.
I'm not looking.
You must play for the Seahawks.
I was going to go there with the word cheating, but you brought it up. So everyone listening knows who the real alleged – Fausters are in the NFL, but I didn't. You brought it up.
Even
I didn't bring it up.
The real alleged. That's just preposterous. We'll talk more about the Super Bowl and outcome. Rob Price has a statement he needs to release today.
I don't know if you folks watched the pregame, but you saw some dirt on John Cookman's shirt there, right in the middle of his shirt there. We'll get that cleaned up for game two. Meanwhile, Ward. Gets back to Dorsey. Strong move into the paint. Little floater. Doesn't quite get the Cassie Cox roll. And now there's three players rolling on the floor. And Ward, she's asking for the benefit of the call. I think it's going to be, it's going to be a jump ball. So back over to the Flying Queens.
Well, Jimmy Calmax felt a little bit differently than Lakin Ward did on that. It looked like a good jump ball to me. but, you know. Who are we? We're just lowly commentators up here in the president's suite.
Riley over to Heastand. Just checked in. Reagan Heastand. She's into the game. So I think everyone has played except for Nina Sato on the roster for WBU. Heastand. With Riley back to Heastand. And Gonzalez just had two quick threes. Tough pass. Pulled back in by Heastand. Now four in the shot clock. No, Sato has just checked in. Check that. Number 40, Sato has checked in. So all players who have been listed on a roster have already getting game time here, and there's still 6:55 left in half number one. So Robertson Ellis going deep to her bench early, and you really can do that with a 17-point lead and in command of this game. Get your players some playing time, some healthy minutes.
Right, and they have listed Sato. That's a really bad call. Really bad call. Don't want to call the referees out like that, but that is a really bad call.
I stand corrected. You're about to correct me. Sato's listed at 6'2".
Yeah, she is, and she's listed as a P. Somebody please tell me what a P is. not sure. That's the official roster from the Sooner Athletic Conference, and not sure what position that is. Maybe that's a new position they've developed.
I wouldn't wager a guess. This should have been a C for center, as tall as she is. Anyway,
oh, yeah.
Here comes Dorsey.
And she's actually looks like she has some skill. She's not too lanky and long for her athleticism.
Dangerous pass from Ward to Hill, but she's able to pull it in. She goes right side in a whistle. She drove to the near block. Here it is. Gonzalez with a little push, reach in. Little mini shove. The check with 6:39 left. Lions down 18. Ward, tough shot rejected by Nina Sato. But Lions come up with the loose ball. Dorsey spins, turns. Ward had a wide open shot. Had she turned around instead, back to McAfee. Over to Ward, 15 on the shot clock. Dorsey, screen from Ward. Shot no good. Loose ball. Pulled down by Sullivan. Here comes Riley. And the Lions will stick in that 3-2 defense with McAfee up top. She'll slide down when the ball swings to the wing. And a turnover.
Good.
Are they going to keep it here? Check that. I think they're going to keep it right here with 13 on the shot clock.
Monica Dorsey with the tip, cutting down those passing lanes.
So Warden Cox down low on this 3-2 Amoeba D, like my partner likes to call it. And look at McAfee right there on cue. She slid down from the key and in a flash was down at the block, saw that pass come and picked it off.
That's right. Now you know why she's playing that top and middle roll.
Oh, there's a nice move from Cox. going to call it before the shot. What a great seal. We might see this again. What a seal. If you're a young player watching a forward center, watch Cassie Cox seal her man. Right there, seal and turn. Catch the ball right where she wants it and turns, and she has whistled. That's going to be number 40, Nina Sato, but she's on the ground. So no shot. And now we're going to see Brittany Griffin check in for Coach Beatles, number 34.
Tipped. Good block.
Yep. That was
Honesty Sullivan.
Sullivan. Gonzalez wants three.
Uh-oh.
Nice hustle from Sato. And we're going to keep it here. He's whistling. Oh, he just pointed the wrong way. Check that. It'll go back to SAGU.
I really like
Sato's head.
What we're seeing from Nina Sato. She's a freshman, and that's probably why she's not getting as much playing time as maybe someone, her height would in this league. But I'm sure she's going to earn a lot of those minutes here in the future.
Tough shot from Hill. Tried to go amongst the trees. And overthrown, looking for Hestan. That pass is off the mark from Riley. 5:03 remaining first half. We're stuck at 31-13. Been here for about a minute or so. Dorsey, McAfee out front, Griffin, Cox down low. Of course, Hill still in the game. She rarely sits down. Dorsey into the paint, turns, slides, a one-hander. What do you even call that? That's a little slip jump shot.
Yeah, just
sliding across the paint.
I think most people would just call it a prayer.
It was answered. 16-point deficit now. 10 on the shot clock inside. Sato, pump fake, crossover, left-hand shot, no good. Not a bad move to get into position, but did not release the ball how she wanted to.
She was falling back a little bit. She's going to learn a little more body control as she keeps playing. And
wide open jump shot from McAfee, no good. Sorry, Cox rebound. She hit that shot four times in about 4 minutes last game. And she gets just beat down the court. She looks tired. Cox looks tired, or maybe perhaps it's the ankle, but she is really slow getting back down the court. I get on my own daughter for that. My own daughter, she's a 6 foot, center basically in high school. And when she lumbers down the court, I get on her. Like, you've got to run and fill the lane, girlfriend. Look at Cox just get beat. Like, she's standing still. And that could be a factor. In the second half, this game gets close. You want to keep your bodies healthy, and Beatles doesn't quite have the same bench as Boswick does.
Well, as we suspicion, the SAGU shooting percentage is low, and this has been a common trait this year. They get down, and they just can't seem to claw their way out with any good shooting, and it just it gets worse. They're hustling, they're out there creating opportunities, but it's just not falling for them. And it's just not going to work if they can't get a shot to fall.
Yeah, you see right there, Robertson Ellis telling her troops to just keep doing what you're doing. Play that solid defense. Take your shots outside when they're there. Figure out that 3-2 defense. Don't get caught. Overpassing the ball, and right now you're going to be happy. The 16-point lead with, I think we're under 4 minutes and change left. Need to get some buckets and some stops here if you're wearing the white uniforms right now. And to keep this game with under 10, you're in good shape. Right now they're down 16 inside the McDiggles. Diggles, no good. Back out to Dorsey. And out of bounds off of Gonzalez. Gabby Gonzalez showing some speed on defense as well as her shooting touch with the ball in her hand. McAfee will check in. Dorsey, 10 on the shot clock. Need to get into their offense right now. Diggles, high screen. Dorsey, 15-footer, too flat, no good. Cleared by Riley. Crosses the timeline. 3:23 remaining first half. Gonzalez inside to Sato, stolen away by McAfee. On up ahead, deflected though. Dorsey able to come away with it off the glass. Tough shot, good. Monica Dorsey just corralled that ball and said, I'm going to go to the basket somehow, some way, and put it in. She's got eight. Meanwhile, other end, a whistle against WBU.
Well, it was a travel, and I don't know if I agree with that call. She caught it and was in stride and went up. It looked like it may have been tipped or blocked, but she made a good play on it.
Besides that bad pass right there, I was about to say, the most improved player I've seen this year has got to be number 10. Monica Dorsey is really impressing me with her basket right there you just saw.
Yeah.
Just one of those kind of quasi-transition buckets, like, I got to make this happen. I got to make this work.
She does. She works hard every second that she's out there.
And there's another one working every second. Gonzalez, her third three from almost the same spot. Somebody put a hand in her face.
I know it. I believe she's 3 for 4.
She's got...
deadly.
She's got 9. Oh, off the glass and off the bench, it's Brittany Griffin.
And we now know why she is doing business with her bank. They're open on Saturdays.
Saturday afternoons, Griffin's got 3. Off the window. Almost another steal from McAfee. Instead,
wow.
Sato recollects.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are seeing a great big lady in the NAIA in the making. Right there. This Wayland Baptist team is always known for bringing in great players. And their recruiting methods through the years have just been phenomenal. And you're seeing another freshman being developed by WBU. She's going to be a big deal.
Honesty Sullivan. Her first 3 of the game. She's got 4. Lions down 19. A minute 26 left. That shot off the mark. And Sato with another big rebound. Quickly up ahead to Sullivan. Guarded by Hill.
Oh,
and
my.
She gets the friendly soft touch. The lead now 21. WBU showing why they are receiving votes in the NAIA women's poll.
And well, I'm going to tell you right now, they are underrated. This team, I did a little research this week on this team. And I don't think the paper, you've got to look deep into the numbers to really see it. But just superficially, you're not going to see. But I really think they could be one of the contenders for the top spot in the Sooner Athletic Conference.
Take a look at we'll check that replay. We'll take a look at these standings. I believe they're tied for second right now behind Oklahoma City. And, yeah, they sure are, John. Tied with Oklahoma Baptist and, that's it, just the two of those. So the three Oklahoma powerhouses on top.
Three games back out of first place, but this is a team that can go do some serious damage in the tournament. They're built really well for the tournament.
The only three teams in the Sooner who are undefeated at home are those three Oklahoma teams, OKC,
and
OBU,
Nina
and this team
Sato
right here.
With 2 really good-looking free throws, and for a big lady, that's quite rare. She is going to be a very special player for this Wayland Baptist University.
Under 30 now, Kroc launches one, no good, and that just dribbles right out of bounds. Let's let that go out. 24 seconds remaining, nearing halftime of game 1 of 2. Top 25 doubleheader, I should say, game 2 is number 21 men, Pioneers. Here on the road, on their road, against these Lions who come into game 25. That's game 2 coming up. 2 ranked teams in the top 25. Air ball there, 5 seconds left. Hill's going to get a shot up quickly. She's got time. Launches a 3, is no good. So we're at halftime, folks. 22-43. It's been all WBU. They were down early 5-2, went on about 11-0 run, and has not looked back since.
Well, this is indicative of a great program. They just keep bringing it and bringing it and bringing it year after year. Can't say enough good things about the Wayland Baptist University athletics program. very solid school. I've always, the little bit, this is our second year in the Sooner Athletic Conference, so we're getting a good look at these schools a couple times a year now, and it's really impressive when you see programs that are well developed.
Let's go down to the court now and check in with Adam Ferguson.
Yep. Thanks, Rob. I'm here with assistant coach Corey Henry. Now, Coach, you're down a lot in the first half. Why don't you tell me what the story has been so far in the first half?
Well, right now, turnovers are just eating us alive. I mean, we have got to be able to handle the ball. Even on a drive. So we've had several turnovers just trying to drive the basket, you know, drive to the basket. So turnovers, we've got to do a better job rebounding.
Now, we've seen the majority of the scoring done by three players in Dorsey, Hill, and Cox. What do you have to do to kind of get the rest of your team involved in the offense?
Well, I mean, we're down a couple players. We lost Charity. I don't think she's going to be able to make it back second half. That's going to hurt us as far as, you know, with athleticism and speed that she brings to the floor. We just got to get everybody going. Be a little bit more aggressive on the offensive end. Monica's done a great job really having the courage to go in and shoot the ball and looking to score. So we just got to get after them second half, be more aggressive on offense, and shut out the turnovers.
Thank you, Coach. Good luck in the second half. Back to you, Rob.
You heard it right there. Unfortunately, Charity Page likely gone the rest of the game. We were just talking here off the air that I think that's going to be a huge loss because there's going to be no one there to help defend against Nina Sato. Cox is there, but, boy, Page gone really hurts Coach Beatles.
More importantly, on the offensive end, Charity Page is the low block player,
right,
which her game is so well respected that that's how Cassie Cox is able to get so wide open. It creates a huge passing lane and gap because a lot of times you're going to double down on the block on Charity Page just because she's so effective scoring down there. And now they're able to really play an easy man-to-man, and you see Nina Sato playing excellent defense on our big men, and she – you know, you hate to say it, but there's not a real silver lining in the cloud right now.
As you see the two teams warm up for game two, it's number 21 Wayland Baptist, number 25 SAGU, and second half of ladies coming up next right here. Stay with us on SAGU Sports Network. We'll be right back.